Okay, so welcome everyone. Thanks for joining. So today I'll talk about what we call exponential families, and I'll give you the detailed definition in a few minutes. But the idea is that exponential families are probability distributions that you can use to describe so the distribution of random variables or random vectors. And in the description of the presentation, I said that these are parametric sets of probability distributions. What I mean with that is that one exponential family is a set of probability distributions, and each probability distribution in the family is characterized by a parameter. And the most basic example is the exponential distribution, which is one example of an exponential family. And when we talk usually about the exponential distribution, we mean, for instance, that the density function of the distribution is given by lambda e to the lambda x. And we talk about it as one probability distribution, but in fact, we define one distribution for each value of the parameter lambda. And so this is the idea, what I mean with parametric set of probability distributions. And I'll define exactly what are these probability distributions, but this is the idea. And these distributions are interesting to consider. We'll see that during the presentation for a different reason. One of them is that they actually include a lot of well-known distributions like the exponential distribution, the normal distribution, geometric, and many others that I mentioned. And they are also interesting because so they give a general framework to look at these distributions and also other distributions of random vectors. And they give you a general framework to do calculations on these distributions. And in particular, we see that when we consider random vectors with a high dimension with many components, it may be difficult to calculate expectations or even calculate the normalization constant of these distributions. And with exponential families, we'll have a quite general framework to do that either exactly or approximately. So this is roughly the idea of the presentation: to define exponential families, explain the motivation, and then look at one way of simplifying calculations with these families of distributions. So for this presentation, I used this reference as a main reference, and this is like a 300 pages book, so I didn't read it with the whole book. I only used the first few chapters mainly. And the main reason why I started to look at this book is because this book talks about graphical models, so probabilistic graphical models like Markov random fields. And I was interested by that because this can be used to calculate probability distributions that I am interested in queuing theory. So this is the reason why I used this book. It also gives a very nice introduction to exponential families. I also used a little bit this second book, which if I remember correctly, Fanfan already presented in a reading group in 2018 when he talked about convex optimization and convex duality. So during the second part of the presentation, there will be some convex optimization that will show up. So I'll use some of these results. And finally, yes?
Just to tell people about the Boyd and Vandenberg, there is also a very nice series of videos where they do an introduction to convex optimization if people are interested.
And I think I double checked because before the presentation, you can also find the reference on the page mentioning the reading group that you organized in 2018. So I think that there are also the references towards the videos. And so yes, I used a few Wikipedia pages, of course, and they are quite nicely written. Okay, so for the presentation, as I said, I'll first look at exponential families in details, and then one method to calculate the normalization constant, which is called variational inference. I should also mention that in the idea is not necessarily to give all the details of the proofs in this presentation. Some of the details, for instance, showing that an infinite series can be derived. I won't show these particular details. I just give the ideas of the proofs, which I think, at least for me, are more helpful to understand the big picture. So what we mean with exponential families, first we need to introduce a few parameters. So first, a random vector x, which has m components, x1, x2, etc., xm. And I assume that this random vector x takes values in the product space xm. So x, a calligraphic x1 will be the set of values that the random variable x1 can take, calligraphic x2, the set of values of x2, and so on. And in this presentation in particular, I'll assume that the sets calligraphic x1, 2, 3, etc. are discrete, and also for most of the presentation finite, so that the set of possible values of the vector x is also finite. You can also generalize the results that I give to infinite discrete sets and continuous sets, just basically replacing finite sums with integrals or with infinite sums. But for the presentation, it will just simplify the discussion. So X has M components. The second element that I introduce is a vector valued function phi. So phi takes elements of the state space of X, of calligraphic Xm. And to this n-dimensional vector, it associates an n-dimensional vector phi of X. So phi 1 of X will be the first component of this vector, etc. And phi n of X will be the nth component of the vector. And we simply assume that this vector belongs to R to the n. So so you take an n-dimensional vector and associate an n-dimensional vector. And these functions, phi 1, phi 2, etc., will be called the sufficient statistics of the exponential family. And it's not straightforward here right now to explain why we call these sufficient statistics, but it will become clear later. And the last notation that I need to introduce is a vector theta with n components. And this vector theta, which belongs to R to the n, will be called the vector of canonical or exponential parameters. So with these three elements, I define the exponential family associated with the sufficient statistics with phi as the collection of probability mass functions given by this expression here. So this is an element of the exponential family will be a distribution of x, of the vector x, and it's given by e to the factor, the scalar product of theta and phi of x minus a function a of theta. So just to make it clear, I can rewrite it as pi theta of x equals a to the minus a of theta multiplied by e to the power theta 1 phi 1 of x plus etc. theta n phi n of x. So phi of x and theta of x, these are two n-dimensional vectors, so I can take their dot product. And the e to the minus a theta, a of theta, this will simply be a constant that will be here to normalize the distribution. And A will depend on theta. So in other words, one exponential family will be defined by a state space calligraphic Xm and a function phi of x. And the set of probability distributions, each probability distribution in the set will be characterized by a given vector theta. So I hope that the setting is clear. Otherwise, you can ask a question, of course. I'm not sure that I can see easily in the chat, but yeah, you can just unmute yourself.
Céline, I just have a short question, and maybe you will introduce this after. I do not remember the your agenda. Do you have some simple example of exponential families for?
Yes. Yes, yes, I have like a whole section of examples.
Okay, so we will see later. Okay, just to help in understanding what it means.
Yeah, sure. It will make it more concrete in a few slides. Yes.
I have a small question.
Sure.
Could you explain in a few words why exponential families are useful?
Yes. The motivation that I'll give later, one motivation is that if you look at a random vector X and you assume that you know, let's say, the expectation of X1, X2, Xm, etc., and you want to retrieve to find what is a likely distribution for X. So you just observe the expectations of the components of X. Then a good candidate, and I'll explain why later, a good candidate of distribution for X will be an exponential family. So this is one reason why you may want to look at exponential families. If you consider a vector and you observe the expectations of each of its components, for instance, a good candidate will be within the an exponential family, and then you would just have to find the good parameters. And another motivation for me personally is that there are a lot of queuing models, for instance, whose state distribution can be described as part of an exponential family. And knowing that allows you to directly apply the tools of exponential families to these models.
Okay, so if I rephrase it, in short, you try to learn a distribution according to a set of observations by assuming that your distribution is exponential. Is it fair to say that?
Yes, okay. It will see that exponential families are good candidates for multiple reasons.
Okay, and okay. I know that I already asked this question, but in another session of this working group, but I like to ask it to understand the positioning of the work. How is it related to expectation maximization algorithm? Is it related or not at all?
I think it's related because I saw it in the book, but I didn't study this particular chapter in detail, so I'm not sure that I can understand. But I can give you a reference, I think, in the book, showing the relation. I think it's somewhere.
I just mentioned this algorithm because this is the very standard one when you try to learn a distribution from observation. And so that's why I was asking this question. But it's no problem.
it's actually a good question. And later on, I'll try to make the connection with other well-known algorithms. One of them, I know that you know it. It's the belief propagation on, you know, the Viterbi-like algorithms where you propagate messages.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also related to this kind of algorithms. Maybe it will make sense.
Okay, thank you.
Céline, in the same spirit as the one of Marco, when you say that it is a good candidate for distribution knowing the
expectation. Yes.
So there are some ways to, when you know things about distribution, there are some ways to get the maximum likelihood distribution according to the knowledge you have, which here is the one of the expectation. Is it the one that is it the result of this problem of maximizing the likelihood of distribution?
The way I will present it in the presentation will be by saying, among all distributions that lead to this expectation,
yeah,
I will choose the one that has the highest entropy.
Yeah, okay.
And so this is the way I present it in this presentation.
I think it corresponds. I don't. I do not master too much this theory of finding distribution according to some knowledge you have on this distribution, but I've read things in the past about it. I think what you said is a bit like that.
Yeah. Okay. Any other question?
Yes, Celine, this is Daniel speaking. Good to see you back at Links first. And I was wondering whether the vector X could belong to any space, not only to Rn. Because the fact that you introduce the phi, which are in Rn, may generalize the usual definition of a random vector, right?
Yes, yes. I think it can definitely belong to more general spaces. And for instance, in some cases that I was interested in for queuing theory, I didn't use a product. So meaning that I couldn't write calligraphic Xm as x1 times x2 times etc xn, and so this is already one generalization. And then yes, I think you can definitely have more general spaces. For instance, if you assume that you have an arbitrary finite discrete space, it doesn't really matter whether it would be integers or something else.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Last question, if I may. In your model, what is known and what do you try to tune? I guess you will try to tune the theta. Or,
yes.
Am I right?
Yes. I guess it depends on the application, so I won't spend too much time on this. But yes, one case would be, you know, the state space of X. You know the sufficient statistics that you have. Mm-hmm. And you also may know the expectation of the components or other expectations, and mm-hmm. you want to deduce the parameters theta.
Okay.
And we'll explain why later, but this is actually a quite difficult problem in general, even if you're mm-hmm. not considering exponential families.
Okay, okay.
Okay. Okay, so with this definition. So we have p theta of x, which is e to the power dot product of theta and phi x minus a of theta. And I already say that a of theta, so obviously it's a function of theta, and I choose it so that the distribution sums to one. So this is what I say in the next slide. Sorry, I just wanted to make two additional remarks here. You can generalize this definition of exponential families. I won't consider it here because I think it doesn't change very much to the results that I give. It just you just have to modify some details. So one generalization consists of replacing theta with a function eta of theta. So you would have to adjust the dimensions to make it fit, but this can be advantageous when you know some information on the structure of the coefficients of the exponential families. And but I won't spend too much time on this today. Another generalization which can be useful consists of multiplying everything with a function h of x, which doesn't depend on the parameters theta. And again, it doesn't change too much to the results, but it makes you can represent more situations using that. And in general, the representation of a probability distribution or a set of probability distribution as an exponential family won't be necessarily unique. We'll see an example of that later. And so yes, it will really depend what you define as phi and what you define as theta that will make it an exponential family.
Céline, I have a last question from your last.
Sure.
So in fact, what I understand here is that your family is very useful because the log likelihood is linear, right? So
yes.
When you maximize the log likelihood, you will have a linear program, in fact.
Yes. I didn't plan to spend too much time on this, but I can make a comment, I think, later on that. Indeed, the log likelihood will come up, and it will have a quite simple expression as a function of a of theta.
Right.
Okay. So I won't discuss too much these generalizations later, but I just wanted to observe that they exist and you can find them in the literature. So with our current definition of exponential families in mind, as I said, the function a of theta, you can deduce its expression using the normalization condition. And in general, we'll call it the log partition function or the cumulant function. So I'll explain why in a minute. I just to make sure that it's clear, this is because you need to have the sum over x of p theta of x equals 1. And this, you can rewrite it as e to the minus a of theta times the sum over x of e to the theta dot product of phi of x. So if you solve this equation, you get that a of theta is the log of the sum over x of the e to the theta dot phi of x. So this is the first expression. We call it the log partition function because in physics, it can happen to find these kind of distributions, and the sum, so what's inside the log, is called the log the partition function in this case. So here you take the log of this partition function. And the fact that it's also called the cumulant function, it comes from the similarity in, if you think of probability distributions, with a transform of a probability distribution, which is called the cumulant generating function. So that's where the definition comes from. And you can already observe that even if we have a discrete state space, it would be difficult in general to calculate this value. And the reason is that if you recall that xm is the product of x1 times x2, etc. You can imagine, for instance, that each of the xi is just composed of two elements, 0 and 1. So each component of the vector can only take two values. Then in this case, the sum will contain 2 to the m coefficients. So you will have 2 to the m terms to sum. So if you just do it naively, like if you just make the sum, you will have many, many terms to sum whenever m is large. So in general, this would be a difficult problem. And we also introduce omega, which is called the domain of this log partition function A. And this is simply the set of canonical parameters theta for which a of theta is a finite, has a finite value. So in the case where the state space x is finite, of course, this quantity will always be finite. So omega will be equal to r to the n. But in general, if you have an infinite sum or an integral, the omega may be smaller than r to the n. I just have two last comments to make, and then we'll move on to the examples. First comment, I assume at least in the book that I read, they assume that the domain omega is open. I won't spend too much time on it because it's in many practical applications, it will be the case. There may just be some weird examples where this domain is not open. The other assumptions that is made is that the representation, the dot products, the representation of the family is minimal in the sense that the dot product theta times phi of x is not a constant, is never a constant irrespective of the value of theta. And the way you can express this is that you cannot find a non-zero vector theta, so a vector which has some non-zero components, such that the dot product theta times phi of x is a constant. The advantage of making this assumption is that you will, for each parameter theta will define a different probability distribution inside the exponential family. So it's just to avoid that you have two parameters theta that give you the same distribution. And it will make some of the results simpler to express. I skip the next slide because I prefer talking in more details about the motivation. So one first motivation is that it can represent a lot of common distributions. And I have a few examples of these. One, I know that it's a continuous distribution, but given the names, it's really tempting to talk about it. One is the exponential distribution. So if you look at the exponential distribution, you can write its density function f as lambda e to the minus lambda x. That's the most common representation. And you can rewrite this expression as e to the log of lambda times e to the minus lambda times x. So you can again rewrite it differently. So e to the minus lambda x minus the log of 1 over lambda. And it may sound counterintuitive to write this distribution this way. The advantage is that here it's clear that it defines an exponential family. Just replace lambda minus lambda with theta. So you get e to the theta x minus a of theta with theta equals minus lambda and a of theta equals minus log of minus theta, if I didn't make a mistake with the minus and inverses. And so here with this representation, you see that for a unidimensional vector, so with m equals 1, this defines an exponential family where the sufficient statistic, you just have 1, it's given by phi 1 of x equals x. Okay, so this is one example. I detailed a second example with the normal distribution because I think it shows an interesting remark that I did. So with the normal distribution, usually you write phi of x equals 1 over sigma square root of pi e to the minus 1/2 of x minus mu divided by sigma to the square. So this is a standard representation of the normal distribution. If you develop the product and rewrite it a little bit, you can obtain the following alternative expression. So you again have 1 over sigma square root of 2 pi times e to the minus 1 over 2 square root 2 sigma square, sorry, times e to the minus 1 over 2 sigma square x square plus mu over sigma square times x. And with this second representation, you can rewrite it as an exponential family where you have two sufficient statistics, one which is phi 1 of x equals x, another which is phi 2 of x equals x square. And so this is what we see here and there. And then maybe I won't give the whole details, but you can have, you can define the parameters theta 1, theta 2, and the function of theta. So this is a case where m equals 1 because you have a univariate variable, and the dimension of the theta is 2. So this is a second example. Maybe I won't give all the expression for all the distributions that I had in mind because it may take a lot of time unless you would like to have more details. But
just a comment saying yes. About the normal distribution and the question I had before. In fact, I remember that the normal distribution is the most probable distribution if you know the average and the standard deviation.
Yeah, and actually,
and I am quite amazed because I didn't know the exponential families, but I was not expecting to have something that can be represented by something that as you define as an exponential family for the normal distribution. So yeah. I understand a bit more what is behind the normal.
Okay, cool. And yeah, I was surprised as well, actually, because I didn't think that these, when I first looked at them, I didn't think that they were so general, actually. So another example is the beta distribution. And in terms of discrete random variables, you can also represent the geometric distribution, for instance, or the Bernoulli distribution, the binomial distribution. For this binomial distribution, there's one thing that you have to be careful about. It defines an exponential family if you assume that the parameter n, the number of trials, is a constant, because you need to make sure that the state space is fixed. And then the parameter that can vary within the exponential family is the success probability p. And again, you will have a log of p that will come up when you define the parameters, the canonical parameter theta. And also the Poisson distribution is another example. For these two distributions, also you need to add the multiplicative coefficient a of h of x that I gave earlier. So it's you need the generalization of exponential families. Other distributions that can be represented are, for instance, the log normal and the Pareto distributions, which usually are considered as more heavyweight than the ones that we see here. So yeah, I just wanted to mention that these can also be represented using exponential families. So these are four examples of univariate distributions. I also have two examples of multivariate distributions. So the case of vectors, and one of them, which was the motivation of the book that I read, is probabilistic graphical models. And the example that they especially like is a Markov random field. So I won't define it in general. I just show you this example to give you an idea. So a Markov random field, it describes a set of probability distributions on a vector. In this case, we'll have a vector with four components, x1, 2, 3, 4. And you represent the relations between random variables using a graph. And so when you describe the probability mass function of the random vector, you will have one factor the distribution will have a product form, and you will have one factor for each click or for each maximal click in the graph. So in this particular example, the maximal clicks, these are just the edges because you don't have any triangle in the graph. So the distribution will be the joint distribution of x1, 2, 3, 4 will be written as a product of four factors, one for the edge x1, 2, another for the edge x2, 3, x3, 4, and x1, 4. If you wanted, you could also add factors for the smaller clicks, which are just the nodes by themselves. So one factor for x1, for instance. It would not change how many things you can represent using this distribution, but it may be more convenient as well. Here we'll just focus on this representation with four factors. So the assumption that we make in order to represent this as an exponential family is that the factors only take positive values. It cannot happen that a factor takes the value zero within the state space. And the reason, the advantage is that then we can, if this factor is strictly positive, we can rewrite it as e to the power the log of this factor, basically. So the representation would be a little more complicated than this. For instance, to represent this as an exponential family, we'll replace the factor fa of x1, x2 with a product of exponentials. So for this particular representation, to make it simpler, I assume that the components x1, 2, 3, 4 can only take two values, 0 and 1. And so here we'll have one factor for each possible value of the couple x1, 2. Here, this is the factor corresponding to x1 equals x2 equals 0. There, the factor corresponding to x1 equals 0, x2 equals 1, and so on. So you have one factor for each of these values. Now, in the other part of the exponential, you have the log of the corresponding value of the factor. So here, this is when x1, 2 equals 0, x1, 2 equals 0, 1, etc. And you can verify that indeed this will be equal to the factor fa of x1, 2, because for instance, if x1, 2 equals 0, 0, here in this factor, you will have a 0. So this will just give you a 1. There you will also have a 0, there 0. So the only factor which will be non-zero will be this one. And so in the end, you will get e to the log of fa of 0, 0, which will give you fa of 0, 0. So, so here you see one way of representing this Markov random field using an exponential family. For me, at least, it looked weird to use this representation at first. But we'll see that it makes sense to use these. Here, the sufficient statistics will be the indicator functions, for instance, one of x1, 2 equals 0, 0. And so you have one sufficient statistic for each couple of random variables and each possible value of this couple. So I hope that this is clear. In general, it's known for probabilistic graphical models that calculating the normalization constant or other marginal distributions is a difficult problem. It's a combinatorial problem because you have a lot of possible values to look at. So this is one of the problems that will be tackled using exponential families. Last example, I'll move quickly on this, is stochastic systems. So for those who don't know me, I really like Turing theory. I did my PhD about it. And I like, in particular, a specific class of models in Turing theory, which are called product form Turing models. So I just show you one to explain why I'm interested in this. So here, this is what we call an MM1 processor sharing queue with two customer classes. So in the model, customers arrive from the left, they enter the queue for a while, and then they are served by the server, and eventually they leave. And here with this representation, you can see that in the queue, you have four customers, one of class one at the head, then a second of class one, then one of class two, then one of class one. So here they are ranked, ordered in their arrival order. With this particular model, I make really simplifying assumptions. So for those who know, I assume that the arrival process is Poisson and the service times are exponentially distributed, but you can generalize this. And it turned out that this model defines a Markov process, and the stationary distribution of this Markov process has a closed form expression. It's given by this quantity. So here, so X is a two component vector, X1, X2. X1 gives the number of customers of class one and X2 the number of customers of class two. And this stationary distribution is equal to some normalization constant written as one minus rho multiplied by something that only depends on X multiplied by rho one to the X1 times rho two to the X2. Where row one and row two, you can see them as loads associated to the classes. And this distribution can be, you can see that it's actually an exponential family because you can rewrite it as, so you still have x1 plus x2 choose x1 times e to the x1 log of rho 1 plus x2 log of rho 2 plus the log of 1 minus rho 1 minus rho 2, which is what I define as rho. So here you will see that you have two sufficient statistics, one which associates x1 with the vector x1, x2, and the other that associates the vector x2. And the canonical parameters will be theta1 equals log of rho 1 and theta2 equals log of rho 2. And so the reason why I started looking at these exponential families is that here with this, you cannot really represent this distribution as a Markov random field, for instance, because you have this coefficient x1 plus x2 choose x1 that doesn't satisfy the assumptions of Markov random fields, but still it fits into the structure of exponential families. And again, the difficulty is to calculate the normalization constant and the long-term performance metrics. So this is the first motivation for looking at these distributions. Now I'll move on to the second distribution, and maybe I'll move on quickly because we already discussed this idea with Ludovic earlier, that's the fact that these distributions, exponential families, can be seen as maximum entropy distributions. So what do I mean with that? I'll again introduce a random vector x and a sufficient statistics given by the function phi. And here, instead of introducing a parameter theta as I did before, I'll introduce a vector mu giving the what we call the vector of mean parameters. And the one question that you can ask is, for a given vector mu, can I find a distribution p on xm? So that's the, if you take the expectation of the vector phi of x, assuming that x follows the distribution p, can I find a distribution p so that this expectation is equal to mu? So here you can remark that I'm not even mentioning exponential families. I'm just looking for one distribution P that satisfies this equality. And I'll skip the next definition because I see that I'm running a little out of time. It turns out that for many vector of mean parameters mu, there are multiple distributions that may satisfy this condition. So multiple conditions, multiple distributions, so that the associated mean is equal to mu. So in order to choose one distribution, a criteria consists of saying, I'll choose the distribution P that maximizes the Shannon entropy. And this is called the principle of maximum entropy. And so here, this is just a reminder of the definition of the Shannon entropy. The idea of this criteria of maximizing the Shannon entropy is to make the to minimize the assumptions that you make on the distribution P. And it has other names. You can also show that it's close to what is called Occam's razor. And this simply consists of saying, if I don't have any other reason for making additional assumptions, I should just choose the solution that is the simplest. And you can see it as the probabilistic version of this criteria. And the result is that
just a comment, Céline. Yes. This is what I, in my words, is what I said when I said that we want to find the most probable distribution. In fact, it's related to that also.
Yes.
No, I see the things. Okay.
And so the result is that for most mean parameters mu that you can achieve, it turned out that the solution of this problem, so finding the distribution that has this mean and maximizes the Shannon entropy, the solution will be a member of the exponential family associated with the sufficient statistics. So it will have the form e to the theta times phi of x minus a normalization constant that depends on theta. Fanfan, I'm not sure, should I stop at noon, I think?
Ideally, but the slot is until a quarter past noon, but just for some tolerance.
Yeah, sure. I think that I stopped earlier, so maybe I'll skip the second part and just explain quickly what I was planning to say in this case.
Okay, as you like.
Okay. So this is one additional motivation, and as Ludovic said earlier, we observe that, for instance, the normal distribution, this is an exponential family with two sufficient statistics, one which is phi 1 of x equals x, the second which is phi 2 of x equals x squared. So this result shows you that if you're looking for a distribution that has a given mean and a given second moment and takes values in R, then this distribution will be the normal distribution. Similarly, for the exponential distribution, if you're looking for a distribution that has a given mean and takes values in the positive reals, then the maximum, the corresponding maximum entropy distribution will be an exponential distribution. So yes, this is the idea. The only thing that you have to be careful about, if you don't assume that the state space is finite, is that in some cases, the A of theta associated with the distribution that you would like to choose may be infinite or may tend to infinity. And so this can be an issue. And this is why at the beginning I said for most parameter mu, the solution will be an exponential family, it may happen that for some corner cases, for some specific values of the mean parameters, you actually cannot find this maximum entropy distribution, simply because the distribution that you would like to associate with the corresponding exponential family will have a parameter A of theta, which is infinite. So this is, roughly what I meant. The proof is based, if you look at the finite case, the proof is based on Lagrange multipliers. You write the problem that I've just mentioned, finding the distribution with a given mean and the maximum entropy. You rewrite it as an optimization problem. You write the corresponding Lagrange multipliers. And if you take the derivative of the Lagrange function and you equalize it with zero, you will see that the distribution needs to have this form. So this is the basic idea of the proof. If you want to generalize it, it's the same spirit, except that you will have to consider more involved theories. So I'll skip the details of the proof. And move on to the third motivation. So for these distributions, if you look at this distribution P theta of X, in general, calculating the expected values of the sufficient statistics, it will happen to be a quite difficult problem. So I can just briefly explain why. So assume that we want to calculate the expectation of phi I of X under the distribution P theta for a given theta. This will be given by the sum of phi I of X, P theta of X. And you can rewrite this as e to the minus a of theta times the sum over X of phi I of X, e of the dot product. So in order to calculate this expectation, in general, you will have to calculate the log partition function A of theta, and you will also have to calculate this second sum, which is not exactly A of theta, but it has the same shape. Just add a multiplicative coefficient phi I of X next to the exponential. And in particular, in the previous problem, if you want to find the coefficients theta that give you a given vector of mean parameters mu, this will be difficult because if you look at a given set of parameters theta, simply calculating the corresponding mean parameters mu, it will be difficult. So inversing this function, it will also be difficult in general. And essentially, all of this can be summarized as calculating the log partition function A of theta or a modified variant of this log partition function. So I already said this is difficult in the discrete case because of combinatorial explosion. You have a lot of terms to sum. In the infinite case, well, it's not better because you have to calculate an infinite sum and it may not have a closed form expression in general. And in the continuous case, it's also a difficult problem because you need to calculate an integral, a high dimensional integral. So in general, it will be a difficult problem. And this is exactly what I plan to discuss in the second part, what we call variational methods. This is a set of methods or maybe a way of expressing the log partition function A of theta that allows you to evaluate or approximate this log partition function A of theta. And in the book that I mentioned at the beginning, what they explain is that many existing and new algorithms, like sum product algorithms, which are I think the most famous, you can see these algorithms as special cases of this variational method. And so the all the chapters in the rest of the books consist of saying, okay, we take the sum product algorithm, we explain how you can see it as a special case. We take this other algorithm, explain how you can see it as a special case, etc. So for the last 2 minutes, I just quickly explain what I mean with variational method. And for this, I'll quote the book that I mentioned. So I'll just go through the text with you. So the general idea of variational methods is to express a quantity of interest. In this case, the quantity of interest will be A of theta as the solution of an optimization problem. So the idea will be to write A of theta as the supremum of something over a given set of values. And this optimization problem in general, it won't be simpler to solve than just calculating A of theta. However, you can relax this optimization problem either by approximating the quantity that you maximize or by approximating the set of values that you're considering. And this is exactly the idea of these variational methods. One example is for the case of Markov random fields. For those who know a little bit about that, if you have a Markov random field which has a tree structure, so which doesn't contain any loop, then this Markov random field, the normalization constant can be calculated using the sum product algorithm, or it has many different names. But this sum product algorithm can be designed by observing that in this particular case, both the quantity to optimize and the set of values that you consider take a simple form. And then applying the sum product algorithm in Markov random fields that don't have a tree structure, it will give you an approximate solution. And this corresponds to approximating the two quantities, the function to optimize and the set of values, by those of another Markov random field with a tree structure. So that's it. So I'll go to the end of the presentation. And so what I talked about was exponential families. These are parametric sets of probability distributions. You find them in many applications. And as a byproduct, we observe that many classical distributions, like the normal distribution, can be seen as a maximum entropy distribution under a given moment matching condition. And yes, you can have a look at the slides. I'll send them to Fanfan if you want to have more details. Thank you.
Merci, Céline.
Merci.
Are there more questions?
I think that Shap has one.
Go ahead.
Oh, okay. No, sorry. It was not a question. Okay.
It was clapping.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks. Other questions?
Well, I might have a question. So you gave us a lot of examples of distributions that are these exponential families. So are there some very straightforward examples that are not exponential, that not fit inside this class?
Yes. So one of them is, the case of the binomial distribution, if you let the number of trials vary. Mm-hmm. And the main reason is that if you let the number of trials vary, you also increase or decrease the size of the state space. And this is not permitted by exponential families because implicitly, if you look at the definition, so here you assume that you have a given state space Xm, and there you assume that the all possible values in this state space have a positive probability of occurring. So this is one example. And then I think that if you consider, I never know if it's a Pareto or Zipf distributions, but you know, if you don't have a finite mean, I don't think that you can fit it into exponential families.
Okay, yeah, so because that was confusing me, because I thought previously you said that Pareto could be fit in it, but...
Yeah, sorry, I should have said it's with a given state space, and in particular, one of the two parameters also has to be fixed, the one that defines the size of the state space.
Ah, yeah. Okay.
Then, yeah, there are probably other examples, but... Yeah, I don't have one simple one that comes to my mind right now.
I have a question on this line, in fact, Céline.
Mm-hmm.
So here, the number of components in the vector is finite, m. Can you have something that can that could be generalized to infinite dimensional vectors? Is it something that exists, or I don't know? It's just a question. Eh? When I see the slide, no, I have this idea, in fact. So is it possible?
I really don't know. Do you have an example?
For example, yes, it's just. You were talking about you fix the number of m, but you can embed it in something that is an infinite dimensional vector space. It can be an Hilbert space or on real or complex number. No, we do not mind here. And just to embed the fact that the parameter m may change, in fact. And I just already did just a question. I don't know anything about the exponential families before your presentation. So it just was a question. I don't know if it's possible or not.
Yeah, my guess would
because
be
you can,
that...
Because you can have a scalar product that you write in the formulas, in the with infinite vectors. The scalar product in an infinite vector space.
Yeah, and even if the Xm has an infinite dimension, probably that as long as the
You have n, so it's not the same. Sorry, this is something I missed. Sorry.
Yeah,
so can you have n infinite? That is my question.
Okay. Yeah, if can you have n infinite? I don't know. It's maybe. I haven't thought about that before, and I don't know if the answer.
Maybe
is
it is a nonsense. I don't know. Just a question to generalize to not be constrained to because here you have a set of. How do you call them? You have a set of
sufficient
statistics, but maybe you can have an infinity. You can go to infinity. I don't know. It may be interesting in some cases. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. I guess if you want to see it as you know, with the moment matching condition and maximizing the. Then you would have an infinite number of conditions.
Yeah.
And I don't know enough about like possible generalizations of this proof, for instance, to know if it would still work in some cases or not.
Sorry, it was just a question. I had just looking again at this slide, in fact.
Yeah, but maybe
I'm not sure about the direct link with exponential families, but a useful tool for probability distribution with an infinite set of parameters, they are Dirichlet process in Bayesian statistics, which allows to model your parameters in this kind of. That's just to answer Ludovic.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, it was just a question. I had no. In fact, I wanted to know if you have seen something about that. So you say that it may be possible. Okay. Is this something exponential families? I didn't know about them before, and this relates to something I was interested in the past to trying to find with few moments the most what I call the most probable distribution, and this corresponds exactly to what you go. So you go fast, but I am happy to have the slide after to see the solving of the problem with Lagrangian's values parameters. It's something I saw in the past, but I do not remember everything.
Okay.
And I was wondering for infinity here. That's all. Thanks.
Okay.